السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praise due to Allah alone, we praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can guide. May the peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dear brothers and sisters, it's very lovely to meet you once again. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this journey and this gathering for His sake. And may Allah gather us because of this gathering in a better place in Al-Jannah, inshallah, all together. I was asked to give a short khatara. Then on the way, I figured that you guys are doing i'tikaf overnight, or many of you, mashallah. And there will be also qiyamul layl, the night prayer and so on. So it's just while I was praying, I thought it would be better if we can shed some light on that, in order to motivate ourselves, to get in the mood, to warm up. And in fact, it crossed my mind a very interesting hadith. And this hadith is collected by Imam al-Bukhari in his sound collection, narrated by the great companion Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him. And it is called Hadithun Qudusi. You know the difference between al-Hadithun Nabawi and al-Hadithun Qudusi. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam phrased the words on his own. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrated that Allah the Almighty said, مَنْ عَادَ لِي وَلِيًّا فَقَدْ آذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Whoever opposes one of my awliya, I shall declare a war against him. Don't mess with my chosen people. We want to know who are his awliya. The following segment will explain in detail who are the true awliya, the beloved ones and the chosen ones by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah the Almighty said in the following statement, مَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَطْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. There is nothing can bring my servant nearer to me better than fulfilling what I have ordained on him. So doing the fard is the most beloved deed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes when we go for hajj, you know, Hajjis who are coming from the US, coming from a luxurious society, there is plenty of cash flow, and it's like a vacation. So a lot of people undermine the journey, and they take it easy. Some of them actually say the statement, which I heard more than once, that this is my first Hajj, but I just came to check it out. I know that I'm going to be doing a lot of errors, which requires fidya. I will make it up next time. Behold, your very first hajj is hajjatul Islam. I mean, if you happen to perform hajj every single year in the remaining years of your life, the first hajj outweighs all of that. Why? Because the first is farm, is what Allah has ordained, and the rest are nawafil. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, there is nothing that can bring my servant near to me better than fulfilling what I have ordained on him. مَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبِدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَطْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. Then Allah the Almighty say, وَمَا يَزَالُ عَبِدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهِ. And my servant will continue to draw further more towards me. What are the means of approach, of getting closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Al-Fard. Everybody knows it. A Bedouin once came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, "Oh Muhammad, tell me, what did Allah ordain on me?" The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, 5 daily prayers. Illa an tatawwa, except if you want to offer extra nawafil, yani fasting only during the month of Ramadan. Illa an tatawwa, unless if you want to fast extra, such as Mondays, Thursdays, 3 days of every month, 13th, 14th, and 15th. Fasting on Ashura, the 10th of Muharram, and on the day of Arafah, the 9th of the month of Dhul Hijjah. These are all virtuous fasting, but they are all nawafil. The only mandatory fasting is what? Huh? Fasting during the month of Ramadan. That's why if any person missed a single day of fasting during Ramadan without a valid concession, it would not be sufficient to fast to the rest of his life to make it up. Because fasting has been prescribed as mandatory fasting during a certain time. Yes, you're exempt to skip fasting, exempt from fasting if you have a valid excuse. But without a valid excuse, it becomes very problematic. Yes, you have to make it up. But again, if you continuously fast until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will not make it up. It is called wajibul waqt. It is mandatory during this time. That's why we say, there is a preferable time to offer the prayer, and there is a permissible time, and there is a dislike time, and there is a haram time. When does it become haram to offer the prayer? Huh? When? After the time, qaza. When it becomes qaza, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exempt the person who forgets or oversleeps, because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man nama an salatin aw nasiyaha falyu'addiha mata dhakaraha la kaffarat laha illa dhalik." Once they were traveling and they were so worn out and tired, so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam allowed them to rest, and he appointed Bilal ibn Rabah to keep awake so that he would awaken them for the Fajr prayer. Bilal ibn Rabah said, "Of course." But he rested his back again as a camel and he overslept. None of them woke up except when the sun rang, shed its light on the face of the Prophet ﷺ. So he woke up. And the Prophet ﷺ was very disturbed. "Ya Bilal, I told you to keep awake so that you can wake us up." He said, "Ya Rasulullah, asabani alladhi asabakum. Whatever happened to you guys happened to me, I overslept." So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "No problem." Then they pray jama'ah. But they have a valid excuse, which is a nawm. They overslept. Similarly, if somebody forgot, but if somebody deliberately missed the prayer time, even if he made it up, it's a major sin. In Surah Maryam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَخَلَفَ مِن بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ أَضَاعُ الصَّلَاةَ وَاتَّبَعُ الشَّهَوَاتِ فَسَوْفَ يَلْقَوْنَ غَيَّا. The following generation that came after them, they wasted the prayer. How did they waste the prayer? Not by not praying at all, by rather not praying on time. By not praying on time. And in Surah Al-Ma'un, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ. Woe to those who pray. Behold, you cannot stop right there. I mean, you cannot stop and end the recitation. It's an incomplete segment. أَلَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. Those who are being negligent of their prayer. They pray of time, after the time passed out, or occasionally, once every while. So, not praying on time is a major sin. Not praying on time is a major sin. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, 5 daily prayers, illa an tatawwa, unless if you want to offer nawafil. Fast during Ramadan, unless if you want to fast extra. The zakah, that rate, unless if you want to give extra charity, illa an tasaddaq, if you want to give extra charity, it's good for you. And the hajj only once per lifetime, illa an tatawwa, again, unless if you want to do more than that. And that's why Al-Aqra' ibn Habis, this companion, when the Prophet ﷺ was given the khutbah in his farewell hajj, he was addressing like 125,000 companions. And he said, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْحَجَّ فَحُجُّ. O people, Allah have ordained hajj upon you, so you must perform hajj. He said, O Prophet of Allah, do I have to do it every year? What did the Prophet ﷺ do or say? He neglected his question and he turned his face away from him. But again he interrupted him. And the Prophet ﷺ treated him likewise. And in the third time when he insisted, the Prophet ﷺ said, have I said yes, it would have become mandatory upon you to perform hajj every year. And you won't be able to afford it. And those who can afford it and won't do it will be ruined. Leave me alone as long as I did not ordain something upon you. This is a very important chapter actually in fiqh, where you're not supposed to keep asking unnecessary questions. Okay? So the Prophet ﷺ taught the Bedouin the 5 pillars of Islam without nawafil, and he said, illa, 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 unless if you want to offer extra. But this is what is mandatory, what is required from you. What did the Bedouin say? He said, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ, I swear to the one who sent you the truth, لَا أَزِيدُ عَلَى هَذَا وَلَا أَنْقُصْ, I shall never do extra, nor less. I will just stick to what you said. The 5 pillars, the fard. This is one of the most misunderstood hadith. Because a lot of people rely on the obvious text and they say, well, this guy said, I'm not going to do any nawafil. And the Prophet ﷺ eventually said by the end, aflaha in sadaq. He will be successful if he can fulfill what he said. True, but you're missing one component of his promise. He said what? Again, remind me. Huh? لا أزيد ولا أنقص. I will not do extra. I will not do the nawafil. Yet, I will not make any deficiency. Deficiency, that is a naqs. How would you decrease in it? Let's explain this. And the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith, ليس للمرء من صلاته إلا ما عقل منها. Your reward concerning the prayer would be only in proportion with the part that which you have khushu' in it. The part in which you are absent-minded, daydreaming, thinking about whatever, doesn't count. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, one of you would finish the prayer, would only get 1/10 of it, 1/9, 1/7, 1/8, 1/7, 1/6, 1/4, and so on. Depending on what? The khushu', the concentration in the prayer. Well, this is very problematic. If this is the case, that means most of us did not actually fulfill the fard. Because of that, Allah, the Almighty, out of mercy, prescribed an-nawafil. In order to make up the deficiency in what He has ordained. We are weak human beings. We're weak human beings. How and where did you get this understanding from? From the hadith. From the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَوَّلُ مَا يُحَاسَبُ عَلَيْهِ الْعَبْدُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The very first thing that the servant of Allah will be asked about on the day of judgment is what? Salah. The prayer, namaz. فَإِنْ صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ سَائِرُ عَمَلِهِ. It was done properly, then the rest of his deeds will be perfect. And the angels would take it easy on him in the reckoning. Why? Because the salah have a big check sign. Good for you. وَإِنْ فَسَدَتْ Well, if it was ruined, then everything would be ruined. Well, if you fast on every single day and your prayer is not accepted or ruined, how good is that? As-salatu amududdin, the most important pillar. So in the hadith, when the person's fard namaz is incomplete, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of mercy will say to the angels who are holding the records, انظروا هل لعبدي من تطوع هل لعبدي من نوافل Check out the record of my servant. Does he have any asset of nawafil? Of nawafil? They look, oh yeah, mashallah, he has plenty of nawafil. Emphatic and non-emphatic sunan. Duha prayer, witr prayer, tahajjud, night prayer, taraweeh. Salatul awabin, in between shuruq and until before dhuhr, and also between maghrib and isha. Emphatic and non-emphatic. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, make up any deficiency or drawback that took place in the fard from al-nawafil, so that he will get a check sign. And the rest of the fara'id, salah, siyam, zakah, hajj, will be dealt with likewise. Now we know the importance and the significance of al-nawafil, of the supererogatory acts of worship. The word the nawafil, is there a difference between nafila, nafla and sunnah? Is there a difference between nafla and sunnah? So what is the difference? Oh, so sunnah is what the Prophet ﷺ used to do, and the nawafil is what you do extra. Do we do anything on our own? Huh? Well, if it is based on what the Prophet ﷺ prescribed, then it's a sunnah again. Sunnah, no. Sunnah, you don't have to do it. It is voluntary. It is supererogatory. It is nafl. So a nafl is a bigger name that covers all the sunnah. Then there will be subdivision. The sunnah will be other emphatic or non-emphatic. يعني emphatic. Emphatic, يعني مؤكدة, confirmed. It is something that the Prophet ﷺ used to observe on a regular basis, and he skipped it occasionally for a reason. Why would he skip it deliberately? Thank you. Barakallah fi. So that the brother won't come one day and say, you have to do it. No, you don't. Why? I mean, you should, in a sense that you'll be rewarded for it, of course. But it is not mandatory. It's only good for you to do it. But if you don't do it, you would only miss the reward. You would not be punished for not doing it. That's called nafl, that is called sunnah. So a sunnatul mu'akkada is something which the Prophet ﷺ used to observe on regular basis, and he skipped it occasionally. The mother of the believers, Aisha radiallahu anha, said, إن كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يدع العمل وهو يحبه خشية أن يفرض على أصحابه. So beautiful. She said sometimes the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would deliberately cease or stop doing some of the good deeds that he used to do deliberately. Why? So that it would not be treated as mandatory. People would get the point. It is mere nafl. Right? It is mere nafl. Can you give me an example of an emphatic sunnah? Huh? 12 rak'ahs of every day and night before and after the prayers. The 2 rak'ahs before fajr are the most important. Wallahi, listen to this. The Prophet ﷺ said, these 2 rak'ahs are better than the whole world and what it contains. The nafl, so what about the fajr itself? Huh? If the 2 rak'ahs, the sunnah before fajr, better than the whole world and what it contains. The whole world. If somebody flies 5 stars, if somebody stays in a 5-star hotel or whatever, he feels like very special, right? He received a great treat. This is nothing. The two rak'ahs before Fajr, better than the whole dunya and what it contains. So I want you to imagine how great, how valuable would be the Fajr prayer, especially in Jama'ah, which will be witnessed by the two shifts of the angels. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Isra, وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ إِنَّ قُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا. The recitation of the Quran during the Fajr prayer is a very special one. Why? Because it has been witnessed. By whom? Not only by you, by the angels. There are two shifts of the angels, night shift and day shift. They all meet in exchange in the shift. During the Fajr prayer, they come to attend the prayer and enjoy listening to the recitation of the Quran. Don't miss this opportunity. Two rak'ahs before Fajr, four rak'ahs before Dhuhr, two rak'ahs after Dhuhr. If you want to do two and two, or four and two, or two and four, or best four and four, because there is a hadith, whoever offers four before and four after, the fire of hell will never touch his flesh. If you observe that on a regular basis, and also do not treat it as fard, rather skip it once. Or for instance, if you're traveling right now, I prayed Isha with you. I prayed Maghrib first, then I prayed Isha. I combined because I'm traveling. I didn't pray the Sunnah in between. Nor did I pray the Sunnah of Isha. It's an emphatic Sunnah. Rather, right away I prayed the witr, three rak'ahs, and that's it. Because I'm exempt from offering any nawafil other than the two rak'ahs before Fajr and the witr prayer. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to observe them even if he was traveling. So he counted two before Fajr, four before Dhuhr, two after Dhuhr, two after Maghrib, and two after Isha. These are the 12 rak'ahs which have been reported in the Sahih Hadith. Whoever would observe them on a regular basis, what will he get? Allah will build him a house in Al-Jannah, in Paradise. Not in Beverly Hills? Huh? No, in Al-Jannah. Very simple. Back to the hadith. We said about the subgroups, emphatic and non-emphatic. Give me some examples of non-emphatic sunan. La, before and after dhuhr, emphatic. Before asr, four rak'ahs before asr, non-emphatic. Before maghrib, two rak'ahs, non-emphatic. Before isha, non-emphatic. Now, the sunnah or sunnah to duha or ishraq, there are different opinions whether it's emphatic or non-emphatic, etc. But the hadith of Aisha applies to the sunnah. Sometimes the Prophet ﷺ would pray it on a regular basis, and sometimes would see so that people would not treat it as a wajib or a farḍ. Again, we want to remember the hadith which we started with. Why do we offer the nawafil? Because simply we forget a lot in the prayer. Who remembers what the Imam recited in the first rak'ah in Isha? Which surah? Very famous ayat, even if you're not hafiz. Huh? Surah Al-Fatiha? Good for you. That's a wonderful answer, man. I like the answer. That's very smart, Allah. That's a very tricky answer. Huh? After Surah Al-Fatiha, what did he recite? You see? Even though everybody knows this ayat, trust me, everybody knows them. Everybody knows وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَابِلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Everybody knows وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ. Everybody knows this ayat of Surah Al-Imran. You know what? Satan would come to you, hey, ready man, for what? For tahajjud. It's going to be a good night. It's going to be a long night. Just think about the fard. You're distracted thinking about what will come, even though it's a good deed, but it's just a mean of distraction. It's just a mean of distraction. So because we forget a lot, and we get absent-minded, and we daydream in the prayer, and we lose khushu'ah, There comes a role of a nafl to make up our shortcomings in the fard. So when the Sahabi said, La azidu wa la anqus, he meant, I shall do it perfect. Well, if you can do it perfect, fine, but I doubt. I doubt. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Aflaha wa abihi in sadaqa. Successful indeed if he can stick to what he said. If he can just fulfill, it's very hard. It's very hard. All of us while fasting Ramadan, sometimes we get angry, sometimes we lose our temper, sometimes. So make up these shortcomings by fasting nawafil. Each day you fast will distance you from the far of hell. How many years? Huh? 70 years. 70 years. So why not fast on Mondays and Thursdays? Nawafil. Especially in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to welcome winter. He said about fasting in winter, it is al-ghanimatul barida. Al-ghanima refers to the war spoils. War spoils, you have to fight in order to earn it, right? What about if I would tell you that you would get the spoils, the booty, without having to fight? Like what? You get a reward with ease. Fasting during winter is like that. Day is very short. The weather is very mild. You don't normally get thirsty. By the time you finish your work, it's already Maghrib time. You know, you didn't really feel it. Versus Ramadan now is in midsummer. So that's called Al-Ghanimatul Barida. And you also welcome winter because of what? Oh, the night is very long. There is plenty of time to have plenty of sleep and also to get up and pray in the last part of the night. And meanwhile, you would rest if you want again. There's plenty of time for the night. So winter is an opportunity. Okay. The earlier hadith, which I began with, hadith Abu Hurairah in Al-Bukhari. And my servant will continue to draw closer and closer to me through offering and nawafil. Now you know every sunnah is nafila, right? Every supererogatory act of worship, every charity extra than the zakah is nafila. You pay extra, you bring yourself closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You recite the azkar in the morning, subhanallah wa bihamdi, subhanallah al-azim, 100 times, somebody else made it 150, somebody else made it 200, he will get closer and closer and better position than others and so on. Accordingly, Allah the Almighty said, my servant will continue to draw nearer and nearer to me via the means of approach, offering and nawafil. This is the area of competition. Until he achieves the following status. And the following status is the ultimate goal of any believer. Which is what? Who knows? Huh? حتى أحبه. So that you will be loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know what? Everybody claims to love Allah. And this is very typical. You know, one morning, this white Christian woman on Sunday in Texas, I was driving and she stopped in front of the car. She slowed me down. So I rolled down the window and said, how can I help you? She said, Jesus loves you. I said, I love him too. Of course I love him. The question is, whom does Jesus love? Everybody say, I love Allah. Really? Do you really mean it? Or is it just a word? What really counts whether your love is appreciated because it is actual, factual, or not. And the greatest level that you can achieve is once you become loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine if the prince invites you to his palace and said, I kept an eye on you. I spotted you. I like you, man. How would you feel about it? Huh? How would you feel about it? A lot of good will be coming as a result of that. What if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you, actually? The hadith began by, this guy is mine. No one could dare to oppose him or hurt him. Inna Allah yudafi'u 'anil ladina amanu. Then he told us the means. How can you become one of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There are certain extreme mystic guys who limited al-walaya to certain peers whom we don't know anything about their background, so that people would do tawaf around their tombs and ask from them. And so now al-walaya is much bigger than that. There could be awliya amongst us whom we don't know anything about them, because they have between themselves and Allah ahwal in the hidden. It is not those who show off because of being an outspoken speaker, being a great scholar in the media, or people actually treat him as a big mullah. No, he could be a hidden person. His relationship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concealed. Allah loves him more than others, and Allah defends him, protects him, and takes care of him. So that is al-walaya. Why? Because actually in the field of competition with regards to al-nawafil, he beats others. Not those who are not praying, and they give them the title of being a big mullah or peer. No. You're doing good deeds more than others with sincerity, you'll be more loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As a result of this love, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُ كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ. Allah said, once I love one of my servants, I will be his hearing through which he hears. I will be his sight through which he sees. I will be his hand. I will be his feet. What does it mean? Can somebody help me to understand the meaning of I will be his sight, his hearing, his hands, his feet? What does it mean? Basically, once your faculties of senses are being controlled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you have a remote control sitting before the satellite, the good people would only tune into good things. Wicked people would tune into whatever, right? The remote control is in Allah's hand. So He will tune you in things which He loves. Even if you happen to be in a meeting where there's backbiting, you would not be able to tolerate it. It's like they're insulting you personally. He can't. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever believes in Allah and in the last day, let him not to sit on a table, on the same table where people are drinking. He wouldn't have to ask, ya Shaykh, I'm attending a business meeting. Is it okay to sit with my managers, with my boss while he's drinking? He wouldn't even get to this point to ask. I can't tolerate seeing people drinking. I can't tolerate shaking hands with a woman or sitting in the same office with a woman who's half naked. I can't. Why? Because his faculties of senses are being controlled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the meaning of his hand would only do what would please Allah. His feet would only walk towards what would please Allah. His sight would only fall on things which would only please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as a result of that, take the following. وَلَئِن سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ. And if he were to ask from me, I shall grant him an answer. Immediately, I shall give him what he asked for. وَلَئِن اسْتَعَاذَ بِي لَأُعِيذَنَّهُ. And if he were to seek my help, I shall grant it protection. Once there was a drought in the city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I believe during the time of At-Tabi'een, and the Imam of Al-Haram al-Nabawi prayed istisqa once, twice, and people begged Allah for rain, no response. It's getting harder and harder. And one day, one of the great scholars went early to Al-Masjid al-Nabawi before Fajr, and he saw a subordinary man praying behind one of the poles, and he heard him talking to Allah, and he was saying, أقسمت عليك لتنزلن المطر. I swear to you that you should send down the rain. He's talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, I swear that you should send down the rain. He said, by the time he finished the prayer, the rain came down in abundance. I was certain that the rain came down only because of the demand of this man. So I spotted him, kept an eye on him. And after the Fajr prayer, I followed him. Then I marked down his house. In the morning, I went to him and I found the guy in his shop. He was Iskafi. You may think this person was a great scholar, a great hafiz, a great qari, a great rich person who's very generous. This person happened to be a shoemaker. He used fixed shoes, old shoes. So he walked and I said, Assalamu alaikum. He said, Wa alaikum assalam. He said, I heard what you said this morning before Fajr. Tell me, who are you? And what do you do that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answer your dua? Before the guy finishes his quotation, this Iskafi left the shop and he ran away. And he never returned back to his shop nor to his house. Why? He wanted this very confidential relationship between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to stay this way. Not to be displayed. Not to show off before people. This is a true walaya. The very special relationship between the servant and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter how much people know about you. Rather, what really matters, what is best, is what people do not know about you with regards to your relationship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the best prayer after offering the fard is what? The night prayer. Why? Right? Because you're doing this in the hidden. Everybody is asleep. And you get up with people like you have been asleep all night long. You don't show that you have been praying. Somebody else can ruin all his night work by going to work and rubbing his red eyes, hoping that somebody would ask him, are you okay? Did you get enough sleep? No, I was praying all night long. It happens. It happens when Satan would ruin all your deeds. الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. So their prayer will be wasted, the reward of their deeds. لَا تُبْطِلُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى. You must have heard this story from me, which is narrated by Al-Asma'i. When a man was praying in the masjid with a very melodious voice and with khushu' that impressed everybody around him. He overheard two guys. One of them was talking to the other, said, look at this man, look at his khushu'. I have never seen anybody praying with that much khushu' before. He couldn't resist the temptation of showing off. He turned to them and said, by the way, I'm fasting too. So be careful. The night prayer is the best prayer after the fard because it is done in the hidden, in the dark. Nobody knows about it. In Surah Istajda, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, تتجافى جنوبهم عن المضاجع يدعون ربهم خوفا وطمعا ومما رزقناهم ينفقون فلا تعلم نفس ما أخفي لهم من قرة أعين جزاء بما كانوا يعملون. These are two ayat of Surah As-Sajda, which means their sides forsake their beds. They sleep very little. They invoke Allah while praying out of hope and fear. They spend in a charity out of what Allah provided for them. As a result, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward them with what? فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ. No soul knows how much reward and comfort for their eyes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have prepared and saved for them on the Day of Judgment as a result of what they used to do. Also in Surah Al-Dhariyat, beginning from ayah number 15, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَعُيُونَ. Most surely the righteous ones will be in gardens and water springs, fountains in paradise. آخذين ما آتاهم ربهم إنهم كانوا قبل ذلك محسنين. You will be taking what their Lord have provided them with, because they used to be good doers before. Like what? What they used to do? كانوا قليلا من الليل ما يهجعون. They used to sleep a little. Why? Because they would be praying during the rest of the time. وبالأسحار هم يستغفرون. And during السحر, plural of سحر is أسحار. السحر is the last hour of the night which precedes the dawn or the fajr. This is the best time, as we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the dua and He descends by Himself to our holy heaven, etc. So they finished with the night prayer and now they make dua, whether outside the salah or in the witr prayer during the qunut. Because of these qualities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considered them amongst al-muttaqeen and He promised them jannatin wa'uyun. And there are various ayat and ahadith in this regard. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sharafu al-mu'min, the honor of the believer is to pray at night. So I guess you're having an opportunity tonight to practice and to maintain this practice afterward. Those who are married, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, may Allah have mercy on a man, on a husband, would get up to pray at night. But he's not selfish. Rather, he wants his wife to be with him in the same status. So he'd awaken her. And if she's too sleepy, he would sprinkle some, you know, drops of water from his wet hand after the wudu, for innocence, not to the bucket, of course. Huh? That you can do to the mother-in-law, not to the wife. No. Sprinkle some water or drops of water after wudu in order to freshen her up so that she can join him in the night prayer. And may Allah have mercy on a wife, on a woman who would do the same. نظر الله امرأة. May Allah brighten the face. May Allah reward with paradise. May Allah bless the person who would do such thing. Winter, as you said, is very beautiful because of the criterions that the Prophet described. There is plenty of time to sleep and plenty of time to pray and plenty of time to make dua while no one is noticing. And the day is very short so that you can fast with ease, especially the weather is very convenient. We want to seize this opportunity and consider tonight, inshallah, as a means of recharging the battery. How soon the batteries are drained. And this is a good opportunity. Try to ponder on the ayat which will be recited, inshallah, during tahajjud. Try to empty your mind and contemplate and be in a state of khushu' and make this a turning point in your life. Then, when you heat up, when you warm up, take it easy on yourself. Because I'm pretty sure some of us will say, man, I loved it. I'm going to do the same every night. Do what? I'm going to pray for a couple hours every night. La, ya Habibi, take it easy. This is the Prophet's advice. Ummul Mu'mineen, may Allah be pleased with her, Aisha said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, what is the best deed? What is the best deed? There have been various answers, you know. But in this particular answer, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, adwamuhu wa inqal. One which is consistent, even if it is a little. So if you observe a couple rak'ahs every night, or if you pray the 8 rak'ahs plus the witr with short surahs, this is very ideal. If you stick to 20 minutes, half hour every day before fajr, please stick to that. Maybe 6 months later, you want to increase the dose? That would be great, because you become used to it. Yani, if you don't wake up, you would feel pain. You would feel very annoyed. Not because you rested, rather because you missed something which will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Actually, you will find its pleasure, its beautiful taste, due to practicing this on a regular basis. And the good news is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whenever the servant happens to travel or get sick and similarly oversleeps, كُتِبَ لَهُ, whatever he used to do in regular conditions will be also stated as far as there were. You plan to get up at night and you overslept, or you once were traveling, the same reward will be stated for you in the last few good deeds. Why? Because he used to have this habit, this tradition. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to what is best. Keep us steadfast on his straight path. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى. اللهم إنا نسألك حبك وحب من يحبك وحب كل عمل يقربنا من حبك. اللهم اغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا وما أسررنا وما أعلنا وما أنت أعلم به منا. أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر، لا إله إلا أنت. اللهم أنت حسبنا ونعم الوكيل. اللهم انصر المستضعفين من المسلمين في كل مكان. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين بمصر والشام وباكستان وأفغانستان وبورما وفي كل مكان يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين بغزة وبكل مكان في أرضك يا رب العالمين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين، وسلام على المرسلين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وجزاكم الله خيرا.